old house is a-getting shaky. This old house is a-getting old. This old house lets in the rain. This old house lets in the cold. Oh, his knees are a-getting chilly, but he feels no fear of pain, 'cause he sees an angel peeking through a broken window pane.
Ain't gonna need this house no longer. Ain't gonna need this house no more.
Ain't got time to fix the shingles. Ain't got time to fix the floor. Ain't got time to oil the hinges nor to mend the window pane. Ain't gonna need this house no longer. He's getting ready to meet the saints. Thunder. This old house is afraid of storms. This old house just groans and trembles when the night wind flings its arms. This old house is a-getting feeble. This old house is a-needing paint. Just like him, it's tuckered out, but he's a-getting ready to meet the saints.
Ain't gonna need this house no longer. Ain't gonna need this house no more.
Ain't got time to fix the shingles. Ain't got time to fix the floor.
Hi, thanks for your patience. After 2-year intermission, here's part 2 of This Old House.
Measures time in hours and minutes. Nature measures time in seasons.
To everything, turn, turn, turn. There is a season.
Summers here in Corfu are perfect with low humidity and moderate temperatures. And fall is a gorgeous season with bright colors and a climate that sets off a flurry of activity. But winter brings cloudy days and long dark nights. Lake effect snows in early winter make this one of the snowiest areas in the country. But the snow sometimes brings animation and a fresh beauty to what might otherwise be a dull and gloomy landscape. New York, and nowhere is the warm spring sunshine more appreciated. Thank you.
Well, Chuck.
Another spring.
Here it is.
I remember,
it was a long time coming, but it finally got here.
Right. We had a late spring this year. You know, for probably the first 15, 20 years I was married, I always used to look forward to coming out here in the spring, you know. It was always so gorgeous out here. And, of course, I used to collect seedlings out here.
Yeah.
And I always looked forward to coming out and seeing my brother-in-law, Chuck, so I could stock my own barren land.
You got the leftovers from that blue spruce. That spruce is dead now. You got them all. I got the beard off.
Chuck and Gladys Kellerman bought an old house in Lakeview in the early 60s. It was on the site of a former evergreen nursery.
See here, really the valley's starting to come in. It'll be in a couple of weeks. Here's your wild berries right here. But it's all going back to nature. It's all reseeding itself or something.
Gladys is Dorothy's sister, and our family spent a lot of quality time together in the 60s and 70s.
This shanty here, it's one of the best things I ever built. I built it while I was working a 12-hour day, 7 days a week, and I used to come out here at 6 o'clock in the morning and work until about 10 o'clock. Then I'd go in the house, get dressed, and go to work, and started working at the shipping plant until 11 o'clock at the shipping plant. And that took me about 3 weeks or 3 months to build this thing. It's the best thing I ever built.
Why?
It holds my refrigerator. Oh, this is my chair made for me to my size. Give me my beer. Thank you, woman.
After 32 years of commuting 70 miles a day to the Chevy plant, Chuck is now retired and looking forward to a much quieter lifestyle.
So from here on, we'll spend probably 8 months of the year in Freeville, and the other 4 months we can travel wherever we want. It's called retirement.
The Kellermans live within a stone's throw of the scenic 18 Mile Creek Gorge. Of course, everyone who came out to visit had to explore the creek and the creek bed. It was a chance to experience the raw beauty of nature. No machines, no radios, no electronics, no shoes. And climbing the cliffs was a challenge and a great boost to a boy's confidence.
We have ended our voyage to the top of Rocky Mountain.
It's awfully quiet here today.
Yeah, but it wasn't always quiet like this. Remember the days when we used to have two or three huge parties a year?
Those were the days.
Yeah, we would have all the our brothers and their families here. We had horseshoe pits down in the corner below, and lights strung over the horseshoe pits so they could play horseshoes at night. We always had a refrigerator with a keg in it, tap.
I remember the faucet on the outside of that refrigerator.
Tap on the outside of the refrigerator.
Just go get yourself a glass.
Yep. And Chuck always said, let it run till it gets cold. We had some good times, though. Remember Freddie and Ray with their families would come out. Frenchie would show up. And all our own kids. I sometimes think half the neighbors wandered in.
Yeah, like Jay says, you never know. I always used to like to go out to Lakeview. You never know who you run into out there.
That's right. Never did. We had to put people just show up. You know, wouldn't even be a planned party. We'd be sitting here on a Sunday afternoon, and one person would drop in, and somebody else would drop in.
Hey, Esther. Hey, Uncle Danny.
Wait. Everything is dog hair on him, huh?
Barkley gets all over it.
The Kellermans were blessed with four children, two boys and two girls. Carl and David were about 6 years older than Jay and had a great rapport with the younger kids. Twin girls, Wendy and Lori, were Lorette's age. They brought a special magic to the Kellerman household. Yeah. Last summer we visited someone we haven't seen in years, my old brother-in-law, Hook Helmer.
I'm all good, partner.
You look like you know what you're doing.
I think so. I hope so.
I've known Hook for 40 years. Dorothy's known him for even longer.
Mama, when your mama used to make potato soup for all of us.
We spent the whole day reminiscing about the old days.
At that table, we make our own damn, we make our own oil cloth of parcheesi. Way back in the 50s.
This lady that makes all the cedar paper.
Yes, she's a great lady.
She gives me so much.
Yeah. Yeah, Steve. Okay, sounds like a good idea. I'll give you a call Thursday, all right? Okay. Thanks for calling. Bye, Steve. That was my brother Steve, talking on my new high-tech telephone extension here. You know, it's been about 4 years since we started making this documentary on this old house. Time is just going by so fast. So many things are happening. Right now, we're in the cyberspace. Email, the internet, cellular phones. I was talking to Steve about the old days, my mother and father. You know, we've taken their place. We moved up a whole generation. A generation and a half. Sometimes you wish time would slow down. I wish we could stop time. Maybe even turn it back. They say you can do anything on a computer. Let's try it. Let's see if we can turn the clock back to 1965, the year we bought this old house. When we first told my mother and father that we had bought a house in Corfu, they were somewhat apprehensive. We had lived down in the valley section of Buffalo, only about a block away, and both our families lived down there for most of their lives. And for someone to move way out in the country, boy, that was shocking. But they got used to it. My father especially got really enthused. He helped me upgrade the electricity in the kitchen. Well, he put in all the new lines for all, you know, the toasters and modern appliances. He used to love to come out here, add his little medicine, putter around, have a little picnic, and bond with his grandchildren. Back in 65, we were four brothers. Myself, Eddie, Eugene, and Steve. Eddie was the youngest. He was going to college at the time, working full-time afternoons, playing baseball, doing a little tippling. So he was a busy guy. We didn't get to see too much of Eddie in those days. Of course, Steve was busy building his own house and building his own family. And once in a while we'd get together. We might go out to Fantasy Island, or he might come out here for the afternoon. But we didn't really see a lot of Steve back in those days. My brother Eugene loved to come out to this place. And whenever he could, he would come out, spend the day, spend the afternoon, let Douglas play with Jay and Lorette. He helped me start the pond. We first started, we had one sunny in there, I remember. He helped me plant a lot of those trees out there. He just liked to come out and enjoy the country. Eugene and I had a lot in common. We liked the country and we liked fishing. C,
Someone we saw a lot of in those days was Uncle Ollie. He was a colorful guy who had worked 40 years on a New York Central. He loved to come out with a case of beer and sit by the picnic table and wait for the trains to come by. He could tell you the number of the trains as they came by and set his watch by. He used part of our field to build a vegetable garden, and it gave him a good excuse to come out here a lot. His son Eddie was a teenager at the time, and he always volunteered to mow our lawn because we had a power mower. He also got stuck pulling the weeds out of Uncle Ollie's garden. That was a long time ago, Eddie.
I remember when this was all a field here. We planted a lot of these trees. In fact, I remember coming up Genesee Street, and you could see the house and the old barn from the road out there. They're changed a lot.
We got together at my parents' house on Fulton Street, where the cousins could play with each other. And there was always some kind of a pinochle going on Sunday evenings. The other times we get together would be on holidays or weddings. After my father passed away, in the late 70s and early 80s, we took turns hosting parties at each other's house, and it left a lot of happy memories. Steve and I became grandparents, and Marianne said goodbye.
know, of all the people in my life, I think the person I was closest to was my brother Eugene. We were close in age, about a year and a half apart, and we did everything together. We played on sports teams, we played basketball together, we went fishing together, we made model airplanes, we went out on dates together. You know, I really miss my brother Eugene. Really miss his company. That was your father.
Yeah, it sure was. He was a great man. I was 18 when he passed away, and he has taught me everything that I am. Everything that I do and everything in my actions is basically because of my father.
What's one thing you remember most? What do you think he gave you most?
Probably a lot of my attitude, my caring, sensitivity, respect for people, to view a person as a human being and to respect that person for who they are and what they are, you know, not just treat them like a piece of garbage, you know, I mean, it's a human person. My father treated me that way, and I treat people in the exact same way. And that's how I am. I treat all my friends with the utmost caring, and I tell them, hey, you know, I'm no important than you are. You know, things have happened to me in the past with my health and this and that, but they're just as important as I am. I don't take front and center stage. And I think a lot of that has come from my father. I've learned that lesson.
First thing that I'd like to do is to save every day till eternity passes away, just to spend them with you. If I could make days last forever, if words could make wishes come true, I'd save every day like a treasure, and then again I would spend them with you. But there never seems to be enough time to do the things you want to do once you find them. I've looked around enough to know you're the one I want to go just for wishes and dreams that had never come true. The box would be empty except for the memory of how they were answered by you. But there never seems to be enough time to do the things you want to do once you find them.
Patients lately, and just that positive attitude. My dad taught me a lot about positive. You know, always look forward. Don't dwell on negatives. Negatives do nothing for you.
just saw took over 4 years to make. It spans four generations of our family and how they related to this old house. We hope you enjoyed watching this video as much as we enjoyed making it. So long. Thanks for watching.